Hi, I'm Leonard. Welcome to Useless Game Dev. All right, you've seen the thumbnail, you've seen the intro, you know what we're doing today. We're building a real-time painterly rendering filter. Let's talk about the state of the art first. There are two main sources I use for this project. One is a talk by 1111 Memories Retold developer Alexander Burke, and the other is a paper on painterly stylization. Both resources are linked in the description. And yes, these two implementations are way more advanced than mine. As you can see in the intro, mine lacks the time consistency and is very bubbly. That's partly because these guys know what they're doing and I don't, and also because of the time constraint. I can't afford to let the scope of these videos get out of hand, so I can only dedicate a few weeks to coding each project, while a proper game production will have months, if not years of work to perfect the results. But enough excuses, let's see how I did, and hopefully you'll get inspired to make something even better. This project uses compute shaders. If you've been following the channel, you know I've been wanting to learn to use compute shaders for a while, as they are a great way to process many small things at once. Basically, you can think of compute shaders as a way to run general purpose code on the GPU. What's the difference though, I hear you ask? Well, consider this simple program on the CPU. It takes two variables, x and y, and there are a few instructions to do some math with them for whatever reason. Instructions are executed sequentially. On the GPU, we will have something similar, but the architecture is single instruction, multiple data, meaning we will have a bunch of sets of data, for instance representing colors in the graphics pipeline. The GPU will still execute a single instruction, a single row, but for every column at once, then the next instruction, then the next. And, you know, we usually put colors in these columns because it's a GPU, but colors are just numbers, and people figured out you could use the GPU for processing other numbers, such as the price of products in a database, or the position of some particles, anything. In conclusion, compute shaders are super fast if you want to process a lot of tiny things, but not just pixels. If you want to get started with using compute shaders, there's a link in the description to a way better video than this one. Why do we need them here though? Well, we're still going to be processing colors, but we'll use compute shaders to quickly do a lot of processing on our image and generate secondary images that will be helpful to determine where to draw brush strokes and how. So we have a base image, let's say this fruit basket. Whether it's a regular texture or if it's fed from the camera, we will need to cover it with brush strokes. The first thing I did was to set up a coverage texture that keeps track of what pixels have been painted. So after a few strokes have been added, the coverage looks like this. To keep going, we can select points where we have no coverage and keep adding brush strokes until the coverage texture is fully white. The issue now is determining where to place the strokes, especially at the beginning of the process, as the coverage texture is fully black, every pixel could be eligible to receive a stroke. We're going to generate a random noise for the image and only retain the values that are above a certain threshold. If the noise changes every frame, once combined with the coverage texture, we get random points to apply the strokes onto. That's enough for now, let's apply strokes. Our compute shader has found a list of points that could use a brush stroke. At each of these points, we can sample the color of the camera texture to know what color the stroke should be. All strokes are then applied sequentially using graphics.drawTexture, which, as its name implies, stamps the texture onto the active render texture. You can provide a material, so I made a simple one that only uses the alpha of the brush texture, but the color provided by the compute shader. This is good, but we have a long way to go still. What if we want to use a non-circular brush, for instance? We'll need to figure out a way to orient each stroke. This means the compute shader needs to be able to provide an angle value on top of the position and color it already does. I had no idea how to do this, but then I remembered using a Sobel filter for the Mobius video. We used it to detect outlines, but it actually detects changes in values along the x and y axis, which gives us a vector that says, in this direction, the color changes a lot. So I figured one other application could be to take this vector and draw the stroke perpendicular to it, in hope that we will draw along the outline. It worked okay. There is probably a more accurate way to find an angle, and I'd love to read your suggestions in the comments. Moving on to the scale of the stroke. My very basic understanding of how painting works is, if you have a large surface with no details, you'll use a larger brush, and for the smaller details, you'll need a smaller brush. We can still use our Sobel filter for this, because the higher the norm of the Sobel vector in a region, the smaller the details, because colors are changing a lot in these regions. We can thus map the Sobel value, which goes from 0 to 1, to a range of scales for our brush, and we should get strokes of various scales provided we sort them beforehand, placing the larger strokes behind the smaller ones. Neat! By the way, if you want to use graphics.drawTexture with rotation and scale, you can provide the TRS matrix like so. Don't put the scale both in the matrix and direct though, otherwise you'll have a squared scale. You might have noticed, strokes take a few frames to cover the entire image. That's because I preemptively limited the number of strokes per frame for performance reasons. This is especially noticeable at the start of the process because there is a lot of work to do to achieve full coverage. However, this cap might not be needed because as most processing runs on the GPU, the frame rate stays well above 60 FPS even when I increase the limit. Alright, what can we do to improve our results? Well, I arrived at the same conclusion as the research paper. Some larger strokes keep ending up in the detail zone, even with rescaling the strokes based on contrast. What I resorted to do was to copy and paste the entire process to create three layers, one layer with large strokes, one with mid-sized strokes, and one with small strokes. When running these layers sequentially, we get a better result. We can also vary the brush texture from layer to layer. But my issue now is that the bottom layer still tries to draw strokes everywhere, including in places where there's a lot of details and we know we'll be placing smaller strokes on the smaller levels. The solution for that was to set a range in the Sobel value to apply the bottom layer on low Sobel contrast regions, the mid layer on mid regions, and the top layer on regions with high details. When combining the three, we get an okay result. It's time to make the scene move. To do this, we're going to come back to the coverage texture. When the camera moves, the existing coverage should be invalidated. However, we're just going to reset the coverage for pixels that have significantly changed since the last frame. This way, if the camera moves only a little, or if the camera stays still but an object moves, resetting the coverage for the corresponding pixels will trigger a repaint for the affected regions. It's already not looking great, but look what happens when the camera moves. Okay. We're not going to go further than this, because this video needs to be out before the next 3 years, but one thing both the paper and the 1111 game do is keeping track of each stroke and its parameters in order to be able to move them along with the camera, allowing for more consistency between frames. My version just stamps the strokes and then forgets about them, and that's why when the camera moves, we need to update the entire screen instead of just displacing strokes. All in all, it was a very interesting project. Very time-consuming project, and even after spending hours trying to get things right, the result is a bit lackluster, which makes you really appreciate the work of actual artists. But I'm glad this video is out, and there's so much more we could do if we had more time for this project. For instance, making sure that some specific objects are always high details because they're important to the gameplay. Anyway, let me know what you think in the comments, subscribe so you don't miss the next video, watch the extra content on Patreon, and have a good one. Bye!